Hi, and welcome to another game replay with Rigel B. My name is Rigel, and today I have a game for you that I played in a recent tournament, and I went ahead and recorded every single round of the tournament, so you will be able to join me on that entire journey. These are tournaments that were played with open deck lists, so I'm going to give you a brief viewing of my opponent's deck list before we get into the game. Okay, here we are for round one of this Mythic Championship Qualifier put on by Star City Games. I'm playing against a Temur Adventure deck with an Obosh companion. Looking at our opening hand here, it looks pretty good. It is lacking a little bit in pressure and gas, but we have good mana, and we have the Innkeeper, which should give us some card advantage if we draw any adventure creatures. And the Giant Killer is a really important card in this matchup because they have a lot of targets for the Giant Killer, so that's going to be a valuable card. This is an excellent draw here, the Lovestruck Beast. It's going to help me both apply pressure as well as get me some card advantage off of the Innkeeper. The first decision I'm going to run into here is whether or not to run out this Innkeeper on turn two. Knowing that it could die to a Bone Crusher Giant or a Spike Field Hazard. The deciding factor here is that I'm constrained on green mana, so I'm not going to be able to go Edgewall Innkeeper into Lovestruck Beast on a future turn. So if I want to get that value out of the Lovestruck Beast next turn, I have to play the Innkeeper this turn and just hope that it doesn't die. If it does die to, a Bone Crusher Giant, at least they're taking their third turn to cast a Bone Crusher Giant instead of develop their own game plan. They might be wanting to drop a three drop on turn three ideally, or you know, spending their mana in some other way. If they have to kill my Edgewall Innkeeper, it could allow me to get a tempo advantage in the game, which I might be able to ride out to victory. Unfortunately, here it looks like they get to spend their mana, all of their mana, playing an Innkeeper and a Bone Crusher Giant, which, you know, that's not a bad turn for them. That's something they're going to want to do anyways, is use all their mana. And so right here, what I'm actually considering doing is using Kabir Takedown on my own Edgewall Innkeeper, which will stifle the Bone Crusher Giant and send it to the graveyard instead of the exile zone. But I decide that Bone Crusher Giant isn't one of their bigger threats in the deck. I'm much more scared of their Goldspan Dragon and their Lovestruck Beast. So I don't necessarily want to use removal on it. I'll make that decision later. I especially don't want to use removal on it before they've spent mana to cast it. I am planning on using this turn to kill their Innkeeper so that they can't get that source of card advantage. I'm not sure if this is correct. It's possible that I should just be playing a tempo game and developing that Lovestruck Beast into, you know, killing their play and starting my attacking and getting ahead on the board, as opposed to worrying about the card advantage. But I felt like they have 12 adventures in their deck. That Edgewall Innkeeper can give them quite a bit of flexibility as they just keep drawing more cards and having, you know, various different decisions that they can make in the future. So we're trying to constrain them on cards a little bit. There was some argument here for me to just immediately Giant Killer the Bone Crusher Giant, because we know that they're running three Great Henges, and so we want to hold them off of that as long as possible. But the Giant Killer is really overtaxed in this matchup. There's endless targets for it between their Lovestruck Beasts and the Goldspan Dragons, as well as the Bone Crusher Giants. And so I really wanted to try and save that Giant Killer for a bigger threat like Goldspan Dragon, seeing as how my Beast can hold back their Bone Crusher pretty easily. So now I have a decision to make. Now that they've played the Great Henge, my situation's not great. I'm going to have to try and end this game earlier rather than later. So I'm definitely attacking with my Lovestruck Beast here. The question is, now that I drew the Shepherd of the Flock, is it worth using the Giant Killer on the Bone Crusher Giant to get in an extra 1 point of damage, as well as use my mana a little bit more effectively this turn? As if I Giant Killer the Bone Crusher Giant and then lay the Giant Killer, I get to spend 4 of my mana, whereas if I just pass with Giant Killer up, I might only spend 3 of my mana, depending on what they do. So I decide that having drawn this Shepherd of the Flock, it's worth it to go ahead and use this Giant Killer to kill that and get in with an extra creature. I think it's very likely that I'll play this Giant Killer, and then I'll use the Shepherd of the Flock to return it to my hand, most likely, since they're going to have more targets for it. And there's some argument for me just returning it right now before they untap, as if they can do something to my Giant Killer in response to the Shepherd of the Flock, that'd be disastrous. With that in mind, I go ahead and use the Shepherd of the Flock right now, before they're able to attack with the Goldspan Dragon, which would give them a treasure token, freeing up any of the red removal spells. And also, I'm using it before they get the draw trigger off the Great Henge, as they can draw Brazen Borrower. That would also blow me out a little bit. Not too much, because it would just kill the Shepherd of the Flock. I'd still get the Giant Killer back. Also, if I allow them to get the treasure token first, they could have counter magic, like they had Saw It Coming, as well as Mystical Dispute in their list. And I don't want to let them have access to that. Obviously, they already had one foretold card that could have been Saw It Coming, and they could have countered my Shepherd of the Flock, but I wouldn't have minded too much. At least I'd still have the Giant Killer out there to start tapping their Goldspan Dragon. Having drawn another Giant Killer, that's a really good result for me, as I'll have an answer for the next threat as well. And so I'm going to go ahead and main phase my first Giant Killer here on the Goldspan Dragon. Mainly, I don't want to give them the draw step to have a counter spell. Obviously, they could already have Saw It Coming, but at least I make them use a treasure on that, as opposed to mana that that's renewable. The treasure is not a renewable resource that they'd have to use. So I go ahead and use the Giant Killer right now. And then the next question I have is, after using the Giant Killer, am I going to develop my board more with a Shepherd of the Flock and a Giant Killer to apply more pressure? Or am I going to leave up my second Giant Killer to be able to kill another threat that comes down? In particular, I wouldn't want to see them play another Goldspan Dragon attack and then play an Alrun's Epiphany and really apply a lot of pressure to me. The fact that they didn't counter that with Saw It Coming, and they have two foretold spells, really leads me to believe that they have some Alrun's Epiphany foretold over there, which could lead them to some pretty explosive sequences if they play a big creature into an Alrun's Epiphany. So that leads me to leave up Giant Killer as opposed to deploying a Shepherd of the Flock and a Giant Killer. I decide to just leave up the Giant Killer so they can't get a big sequence of turns with Alrun's Epiphany a couple of times. Now here, again, I did this Giant Killer in response to the Great Henge trigger so that they had less of a chance of having counter magic drawn off the top. But there is some argument to me not doing it in response, as they may go to combat with their Goldspan Dragon and go to attacks before doing anything else. And then if I can kill the Goldspan Dragon in combat, they won't be able to make use of the treasure mana as effectively. The treasure is sacked for twice as much mana while Goldspan is in play. And so if I do that during the combat step, they could only use that for instance. And so by doing it main phase, they were able to sacrifice the mana and have this explosive sequence where they played another creature and got an Alrun's Epiphany, which they could have done anyways, even if I hadn't gone for the Giant Killer, but they might have stepped into the mistake of going to combat first. They closed that pretty quickly once they hit Alrun's Epiphany, and that's sort of the theme in these matchups, is that it's more or less a tempo game, but if they are doing pretty well on tempo, or even on tempo, and then land a time walk, that's gonna shift the game in their favor pretty quickly. So with that in mind, I'm trying to prevent their ability to have a good board and or cast Alrun's Epiphany. I bring in the Dranith Magistrates, as this shuts down all their adventure creatures as well as foretold cards. I bring in the Redain, sort of to combat The Great Henge, and Alrun's Epiphany. It's not a great card in the matchup, but also having the flyer is somewhat valuable as they have a lot of things to gum up the ground. And so being able to chip away in the air isn't too bad. I'm trimming the Toskies and the Showdown. As I said, this is a very tempo-oriented matchup. So you can't necessarily have as many of these big 4-mana cost cards that are really focused on card advantage. So I'm trimming those. Other things, brought in the Red Cap Melee, just another answer for their Goldspan Dragons, but can also take down a Bone Crusher Giant when it needs to. Or in a pinch, it could take down an Edgewall Innkeeper or something like that at the cost of sacrificing a land. I'm having a little bit of difficulty figuring out what to trim. I decided to trim a Lovestruck Beast as they do a decent job of gumming up the ground as well, so my Lovestruck Beast may not be able to attack as effectively. And then I trimmed another Toski. Again, with that, I may not be able to get in with my creatures quite as effectively as I would in some matchups. That being said, I'm not in love with taking out the Lovestruck Beast, as having a Lovestruck Beast on my side really helps me in terms of not having to kill all of their ground threats as well as their Goldspan Dragon. So it frees up my removal. This hand, it looks pretty good. I have a turn one just Bear Sentinel, which is great. And then Clarion Spirit is an excellent card in the matchup. Just getting endless tokens can really help stave off their attack. And then I have the Giant Killer as well as Kabir Takedown potentially, depending on if I draw other land. Having not drawn other land, I'm going to have to play it as a land. But having a Giant Killer for their big threats is useful. Here I have to decide, am I going to run out the Edgewall Innkeeper again? And I also have to decide, am I going to attack with my Just Bear Sentinel? And if I run out the Innkeeper, am I going to play the Giant Killer immediately? Being constrained on mana, I decide to go ahead and do this, even though next turn I could go like Clarion Spirit into Edgewall Innkeeper to double spell, and get the trigger. I decide to go Innkeeper into Giant Killer right now to draw some cards and help me hit my land drops on future turns. I'm also just deploying to the board as quickly as possible. And, you know, I have the capabilities to double spell in the future with some of my Clarion Spirit and other cheap threats. So they go ahead and get to answer my Edgewall Innkeeper right away. That's unfortunate, but it looks like we're going to be able to go Spirit into a Lovestruck Beast token to create a 1/1. And we're creating a pretty wide board already, as well as taking to the skies. Any evasion in this matchup's pretty useful, as the Goldspan Dragon isn't really going to be left on defense for them too frequently. And their only other flyer, I mean, other than Alrun Epiphany tokens, the only other flyer they have is the Brazen Borrower, which doesn't block your 1/1s very well. So if you can assemble an Air Force pretty early, then that's usually pretty effective at creating a lot of pressure. Another option that I had here was just running out the Lovestruck Beast all by itself. I would miss out on the two tokens, but next turn I could go Clarion Spirit and do a one drop, and that would give me a 1/1 flyer to allow me to attack with the Lovestruck Beast. I think this line here is a little bit better. Okay, so they get to play their own Lovestruck Beast. And again, thinking about Great Henge, it's always risky to leave a 5/5 out there. If they resolve Great Henge, the game becomes very difficult. So I have to at least consider Giant Killering the Lovestruck Beast right now. And the fact that I'm going to get pretty far ahead on the board here, I wouldn't get to to trigger Clarion Spirit this turn with that line, but it would set me up to trigger it next turn, as then I would have a ready one drop to play next turn alongside, say I draw a land, I could go Lovestruck Beast into Giant Killer to double spell and trigger Clarion Spirit next turn. So I think it's useful to go ahead and use the Giant Killer right now to enable that type of play. Even though playing the Lovestruck Beast this turn into Giant Killering next turn could allow me to get a big attack with the Lovestruck Beast in next turn, I think this line's a little bit better. So they get to go Innkeeper into an adventure, which is pretty good for them. But we still have a pretty good board, and we drew our land, which is great. Now we get to double spell, and we have some options. We could go Toski into attacking in the air to draw, but I think it's probably better to develop our board a little bit more before putting that Toski down. If we put it down right now, we're just going to draw the one card, and then Toski itself doesn't apply much pressure. If we go Lovestruck Beast into, say, Giant Killer or something like that, we're going to get the Lovestruck Beast as well as another flyer. It looks like I could be prioritizing Redain plus Giant Killer, as with their ground pretty well blocked up and me having Toski, Taking to the Skies is pretty effective. I'm going to get to attack in the air in future turns. And it actually looks like I decide to, instead of laying the next Giant Killer, just bring back the original Giant Killer first while they're tapped out. I don't want them to be able to respond to a Shepherd of the Flock on Giant Killer with something like a Bone Crusher Giant or a Brazen Borrow. Well, I guess Brazen Borrow is not so bad. But they, in sideboard, they could also have, it looked like they had a Demon Bolt and a Soul Seer, a couple other things. So I just decided to do it main phase so they can't respond. I get that Giant Killer back in hand. And I've successfully deployed an Aerial Assault here. The fact that they spend their turn just bringing back Obosh is excellent for me. Now I'm feeling really comfortable with how this game is going. It looks like I'm going to be able to play a Toski into a Giant Killer this turn. So I get to continue deploying stuff to threats to the board, and I'm going to draw a ton of cards now. I get to keep double spelling with my Clarion Spirit. If they can't answer Clarion Spirit early in the game, it really gets out of hand, as all these 1-1 flyers really add up. Here I'm tapping the Clarion Spirit for mana, as it's the creature I'm going to want to block with the least. So that's why you see that. Now my board looks pretty overwhelming. I don't know how they're going to get out of this. They don't even have Time Walks lined up. It's pretty hopeless for them. I have a Giant Killer if they play anything in the air. They don't have any mass removal in their sideboard. Like, some lists are playing Crush the Weak or Blazing Volley or stuff like that, which would be able to answer a board like this pretty well, pretty effectively. But this opponent didn't have those. They had maybe like a Demon Bolt, a Soul Seer, some other counter magic. They might have brought in Elder Gargaroth. These are options that might have happened, but none of those are really gonna ruin my situation. Here I get to, I was debating using the Toski to generate mana with the Sentinel, as they're just gonna have a free block on it anyways, but I have plenty of other creatures I can tap with the Sentinel, and I wanted to draw my cards first before deciding how to use my mana. And now we just have tons of cards. The advantage is snowballing pretty quickly. We'll probably just go another Clarion Spirit into something else. If they did have something like Crush of the Weak in their deck, I probably would not run out the Clarion Spirit. And would probably just develop with like a Lovestruck Beast type of something bigger that would survive that. But knowing that they don't have any sort of Wrath effects, I can just keep going wide. Starting next turn, I mean, with this Redain out, they really can't even take extra turns, and I can't imagine what they could do in one turn to get out of this, and they can't imagine it either, so they go ahead and concede. All right, we're going to get ready for game three. I'm still sort of debating this Lovestruck Beast sitting on the sideline. I'm not liking it being over there. I think it should be in the main deck, and maybe it should just be a Toski that gets cut, or you know, maybe Redain isn't that important in the matchup. But yeah. So I think maybe it should be a Toski and the Lovestruck Beast should stand. But it's tough to give up on Toski, as you saw that game. When you have a Clarion Spirit going, it's really, really effective. However, if you have a Clarion Spirit going, you're doing pretty well already. It's also possible that the second Toski should just be a Showdown of the Scalds. They both provide a lot of card advantage. The Showdown of the Scalds being able to put the +1/+1 counters on things could be useful as well. The Toski always having to attack, meaning that it's never a blocker, that could be a problem when you're on the draw. They may have the tempo advantage, and so playing spending 4 mana on something that's going to be attacking every turn could be a significant disadvantage. So if I were to think of anything, maybe I should only have 1 or 0 Toskis. Okay, looking at my opening hand, again, it's an excellent hand. Turn 1, Jaspera, Sentinel, perfect mana. And I have the Clarion Spirit, as well as the card advantage of Showdown. Bone Crusher for an early Edgewalling Keeper, if they have that. And if I draw a 1-drop, I get that powerful turn 2 play of going Clarion Spirit into 1-drop, immediately triggering the Clarion Spirit. So we'll see how this plays out. I would love it if they just ran out like an Edgewall Innkeeper and I could just kill that with my Bone Crusher Giant on turn 2. As it is, they play the 1-1 and they do go for the Innkeeper, so I'm going to be able to make use of my Bone Crusher right away to kill that and deny them the card advantage. And then they're already running low on resources with the, you know, 3 cards in hand. If they don't have access to this Edgewall Innkeeper, they may not have the card advantage to keep up with me throughout this game. So yeah, just going to use the Bone Crusher. And then I have to decide whether or not I want to attack with the Jaspera Sentinel. And so basically I would be trading 1 damage for 1 damage. Being on the draw, that's not necessarily a great idea, as they will usually have the tempo edge. And having the card advantage, you really want to allow yourself to get to the late game. The further you can go into the game, you can make use of those resources. So that's why I decide not to attack here with my Jaspera Sentinel. I don't want to trade the 1-for-1. An argument for attacking would be that when they're dealing damage, it's usually in pretty big chunks. And so, like, if they're delivering lethal to me, it's usually not, like, exactly lethal. And so the 1 point of damage may not be as relevant to them as it is for me. I might be doing damage in little chunks and get exactly lethal, whereas they attack for 10 at a time and deal me plenty of extra damage. Here they've played out a Lovestruck Beast. And again, thinking about the Great Henge, it may be useful to get that off right away. Given that I have a Shepherd of the Flock that I'm going to be able to bring back the Giant Killer with, I feel like it's okay to go ahead and use the Giant Killer. As far as why I changed my mind and decided to start trading damage, it was basically that idea that the little increments are much more useful to me than they are to the opponent. Okay, so now with them just bringing back Obosh and not developing their board at all, I'd like to see that. And now I've got plenty of options. I think that the line I'd like to take here is to go Clarion Spirit into Redain as I start to assemble my Air Force that I was talking about. With them, one line I could take is Clarion Spirit into Bone Crusher Giant, but with them having the possibility of just playing an Obosh next turn, the giant Bone Crusher Giant may not be able to attack, so I like taking to the skies instead. Normally, I would just do whichever creature can attack for the most, but seeing as how they have something right there that can brick wall my Bone Crusher Giant, I'm going to go ahead and develop with the Flyer. Also, just having Redain out there for future turns to shut down Great Henges and All Around Epiphanies can be pretty useful. So we go ahead and get that out there. And I like the way this game is shaping up, especially if they don't kill my Clarion Spirit right here. As I'll be able to continue double spelling. I already have a board advantage. This Showdown of the Scalds is going to give me a pretty good card advantage as well. And now I draw Kabira Takedown, which I can use to kill this Obosh, which I'm pretty happy about. I decide to go ahead and risk using a Showdown to hit a land first, as I do want to get all the cards off of this Showdown while I know it can resolve, as well as start putting the +1/+1 counters around on my creatures, making use of those triggers as early as possible. Another idea that I had was just playing Bone Crusher Giant into Kabira Takedown, not risking missing on a land off of the Showdown. And that maybe was a better line, as it does develop to the board a little bit more this turn, and it doesn't risk missing on land with the Takedown, in which case I could fall behind. But I decided to risk it, and it did pay off. Another reason for just waiting on the Bone Crusher Giant is that you never know when you're going to be able to draw an Innkeeper and get a trigger off of the Innkeeper with it. So sometimes, you know, you'll lean towards waiting on the adventure creatures whenever you have a close call, just thinking that you might draw the Innkeeper. And what I hit off of this Showdown of the Scalds looks awesome, as I get a second Clarion Spirit. I get the Edgewall Innkeeper that we've been talking about, to get some card advantage out of Bone Crusher Giant and Giant Killer. They go ahead and take care of my first Clarion Spirit with the Bone Crusher Giant here, but they're down to two cards in hand. They're foretelling one of them. It could be a counterspell. It could be an All Runs Epiphany. If it's All Runs Epiphany, they can't cast it with my Redain out there. One thing I'm going to do with this turn, I'm going to lead with Clarion Spirit. You always want to lead with Clarion Spirit in order to get that trigger off of the second spell you cast that turn. You want to get the 1/1 Flyer. And what I do is I start growing the Redain. My idea here for growing the Redain, first of all, you want to get it big enough to be able to block the Goldspan Dragon. So at least 4/5. I want to, in this case, I actually decided to try and get it to a 5/6. Okay, so it was saw it coming. But now the resources they have is very low. And we just have a huge board, a huge card advantage. I'm building this Redain up to a 5/6 because they did have that Soul Seer in the sideboard that possibly they brought in. And so once I have it up to a 5/6, it should be pretty safe from any sort of removal. And my Flyers are just going to close this game very quickly. And there you go. So that's round one. We get to go 1-0. If you've made it this far, thank you so much for watching, and I hope you'll join me for round two of this tournament. In order to catch all of the rounds for this tournament, you can check them out in my Naya Sky playlist. And if you want to make sure to catch all my future content, please click the subscribe button below. Thanks again. See you next time.